should be every unbeliever's nightmare.
Yeah.
To be on an airplane and the rapture come and the pilot's a Christian.
Right. Yeah.
Now, if I wasn't saved, before I got on an airplane, I'd ask, are you saved, pilot?
Yeah, come on.
Because if the rapture comes, you're doomed. You're going down.
That's right.
You see, the rapture really is going to happen. And it's so wonderful when God explains how. I like how, don't you? I'm glad God gives me information, and then he tells me how it's going to happen. Look at verse number 10. But the day of the Lord will come. It will. And one of these days, you're going to go through your normal day, just like any other day, or just like any other night, and all of a sudden, the trumpet's going to sound. And it's going to sound by Gabriel, and the Bible says he's going to cry out, come up hither! And all of those that are saved are going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkle of an eye. And we're going to get our glorified bodies, and we're going to go meet the Lord in there. All those people that are in the grave and that was in Christ, that knew the Lord as their Savior, they're going to be resurrected, they're going to be united with their glorified body, and we're all going to go meet the Lord in there. And here's his promise. So shall we ever be with the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, I want you to realize Jesus hasn't come yet. Number one, because it's not time. Number two, because he wants more people to be saved. And number three, he is coming.
Yeah.
He is coming. So I want you to realize all these years, 1977 was 42 years ago. That's a long time to be standing up saying, he's coming!
Yeah.
He's coming!
Yeah.
He's just still coming.
Yeah.
Amen.
And he's going to. So here's what the Bible says. Verse 11. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Now here, that all was the introduction. Here's the message. What kind of person does God expect you to be if you believe what I just said?
Amen.
If you believe what I just said, and you believe Jesus really is coming, what kind of person ought you to be? What kind of person ought all of us to be? I'm going to just give you a couple. I could stand up here and preach this all day long of all the different things you ought to be.
Yep.
But number one, if you believe what I said, the kind of person you ought to be is a saved person.
Amen.
You better know Jesus Christ is your Savior, or you're going to get left behind. And in spite of all these other movies that they're putting out there, that finally after the rapture comes, this guy comes to himself and, oh, I better get saved. That ain't happening.
Right.
The Bible says, now you've got to keep back to the Bible and forget what man says. The Bible says, if you've heard the gospel and you rejected Jesus Christ, when the rapture comes, God himself is going to make you believe the lie.
Yeah, that's right.
You're going to take the mark of the Antichrist on you. I'll never take it. Well, God said you would.
Yeah.
So the first thing you need to make sure you are is saved. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of people that say they're saved, and they're really not.
Come on, please. Come on.
Because down through the years, we went through different periods of time where even good churches have messed things up.
Yeah, that's right.
They have. We have, for years and years, fought against easy believism. Where men, I actually went soul winning with a guy that did this, and I'm standing there with total disbelief. He walked up to a total stranger and he said, you don't want to go to hell, do you? Well, who's going to say yes? The guy said no, and he said, well, take my hand, repeat after me, pray a little prayer, and now you can go to heaven. That is not true.
That's right.
Amen. The Bible says you got to believe in your heart.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can't believe in your heart until somebody tells you about it.
Right.
So you got to believe in your heart, and that belief causes you to cry out and ask the Lord Jesus Christ to save you. The Bible says when Jesus comes, there's going to be many that's going to say, but Lord, Lord, didn't we do many wonderful works in your name? Lord, Lord, Lord. And he said, I never knew you.
Yeah, yeah.
Why? Because they weren't born again.
Yeah.
And they're all over the place. I preached at youth camp last summer, had 197 kids in it, man. Those kids listened and responded. The second night I preached a message on, are you sure? 28 kids got saved. They weren't sure.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
The next night I had 10 more saved that said, preacher, we should have got saved last night.
Yeah. Amen.
Now let me ask you a question. Now forget all this nonsense that you got going around your head. Does Jesus really live in your heart? Come on, I mean, is he in there? You say, well, how do I know he's in there? Because the Bible says if he's in there, he's going to tell you he's in there.
Amen.
His spirit's going to bear witness with my spirit that I am a child of God. In other words, he's going to tell me every time somebody gets up and talks about heaven, talks about hell, talks about being saved, the Holy Spirit says, aren't you glad you're saved? And my mind goes back to the day I received Christ as my Savior. And one more time, he assures me.
Yeah, yeah.
Saved. That ever happened to you?
Yeah.
A lot of people that don't.
Yeah.
I've told you the story years ago. I've preached so many times, I've probably told you every story I know. But when I went to Liberty 34 years ago, about 3 years into this, I started had this rash of church people getting saved.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
I was preaching on Wednesday night through the book of Acts. And I got to King Agrippa getting saved. So I sat down in my office on Wednesday morning and I started preparing this sermon. And God just gave me this awesome sermon on almost persuaded, why he was almost, what God did to get him almost, and why he didn't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
I wrote this thing all out and I'm thinking, wow, next time I preach a revival meeting, I'm preaching this sermon. It was good. So I sat there and I said, all right, and I laid down beside him. I said, now, Lord, I need something for the Wednesday night crowd.
Yeah.
You know, Wednesday night crowd is supposed to be the best people there is.
Yeah.
Come on. So I tried and I prayed and I tried and I studied and I read books, I read commentaries, and I just couldn't get anything. Church starts at 7 o'clock and 6:45, I got nothing. I thought, well, I guess I'm going to go out there and say, I got nothing, y'all go home. That's not what the church expects. So finally, about 5 minutes till church time, God told me in my heart, he said, I've given you the message, just go preach it. And I'm telling you, I did it with fear and trepidation. I'm going to get up and preach a salvation message to a Wednesday night crowd. They're going to think I lost my mind. So what you do, preacher? I got to preach it like the Lord told me to.
Yeah, yeah.
I preached almost persuaded. I gave the invitation. And one of my deacon's wives came down, and I thought, well, she's just going to come and pray for somebody. She took me by the hand, and she said, preacher, I'm not saved, and I need to be saved.
Oh,
so I called my wife over there, and I said, Gracie wants to be saved, my wife.
Yeah.
I had no clue. She's one of the best ladies in our church. Worked like crazy. Lovely lady. Most important, she loved her preacher.
Yeah.
That's the most important part. So I was rejoicing.
Yeah.
And just a couple minutes after Gracie came, one of my other deacon's wives came. I thought, they're best friends, so she's just going to be glad that Gracie got saved. She came down to me by the hand, preacher, if Gracie can admit she's not saved, so can I. So I had two of my deacon's wives got saved. In this stretch of time, I had my associate wives got saved. I had my secretary got saved. I had all these people saved because here's what they told me. These two deacons' wives had sat down at lunch and talked about the fact that they didn't think they were saved. Why would you do that? Folks, I'm telling you, there's people all over America sitting in fundamental Baptist churches right this minute that are not saved.
That's right.
And they keep holding on to, but my mommy told me I got saved when I was 5. Surely my mommy wouldn't lie to me. Listen, if you don't remember it, and it didn't change you, you didn't get saved. Amen.
That's right.
Well, preacher, I've been serving God for 45 years. What do you suppose that's going to get you in the rapture?
Amen.
It's going to get you left behind. That's what it's going to get you.
Amen.
Secondly, not only if I, what manner of person ought you to be, you ought to be saved. Secondly, you need to love Jesus.
Amen.
Let me tell you what kind of person you ought to be. You ought to be in love with the Lord.
Amen.
Let me just tell you this. Oh, I never talked to a Christian that didn't say, oh, preacher, I really love the Lord. Well, does your life prove that you love the Lord?
Amen. Come on.
You know, the Bible says if you love the Lord, there's some things that ought to be true. You ought to love the things he loves.
Amen.
My wife and I will have been married 49 years in December. And I know for some of you that's nothing, but it's a long time for me.
Yep.
49 years. Can I tell you that my wife and I, what we like and don't like, has changed drastically in 49 years? Because I've changed to love the things she loves, and she's changed to love the things I love, so we can love them together.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what God wants to do in your life. He wants you to make you love the things He loves. Number one, I'm telling you, He loves souls. He loves people. And yeah. So we ought to love people. We ought to be concerned about people. Secondly, He loves the church.
Amen.
He loves this church. He loves the people of this church. He loves this church as an institution. And I'm telling you, you ought to do the same. And what that means is, if you love the church, you attend the church, you support the church, you pray for the church, and you desire for the church to go forward.
Amen.
God says, you need to love me. I want you to realize love changes people. My little granddaughter was a freshman at Heartland this year. And she found her a boy. Mm. And that's what he is too, by the way, is a boy. And they just are madly in love. It's so funny because her parents, when she went to Heartland, worked in Louisville with me. When I left, they left. And he took a church in Surprise, Arizona. I didn't even know there was a Surprise, Arizona.
Surprise.
He told me he was going to Arizona. I said, where are you going? He said, Surprise. I said, okay, I'm surprised. Where is it? That's actually the name of the town. He said, I'm going to Surprise, Arizona. And you know what's really funny? My granddaughter was having, oh, Papa, Papa, I'm not going to go to your church anymore. I said, no, you're going to go to your dad's, and it'll be much better.
Yeah.
So she goes to Surprise, Arizona after church is out. Guess where her new boyfriend lives?
Right.
No, about 30 minutes north of Surprise. Her dad pastors a church up there in some place. Now, he comes down once a week. And they go out on a date. Now, they don't get to go by themselves.
Yeah.
Mom and dad goes with them.
Yeah.
So what kind of weirdos are they? Ones that care about their daughter.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
That's what. So I want you to know that girl's acting very weird. She has checked out. I probably ought to pay this. But she's checked out all the wedding dresses.